So welcome to 1966. What you're seeing before you is a glowing screen on a small box. There's a small girl. She has dark skin and dark hair, and she is looking at the TV with rapt attention. She runs through the house and says, "Mama, there's a black lady on TV, and she ain't a maid." That woman was Whoopi Goldberg. She is EGOT winner. That means Emmy, Tony, Grammy, Oscar, talk show host, actor, comedian, and also Texas Guinan on Star Trek The Next Generation. I'm in one of my favorite characters in the series. This moment for Whoopi Goldberg is the moment that I'm not actually is going to be my big moment, but one of those moments that leads us to a huge moment in our world. Imagine having grown up your entire life and never having seen yourself reflected on television. Or when you saw someone who looked like you, they were always in a role that you didn't recognize. Imagine never seeing yourself in the future. When Whoopi recounts this moment, when she's traveled through time 300 years into the future, we were only 100 years after the end of slavery in the United States. So when we want to think about what was happening in 1966, so the world as we knew it was not the world that we are in now. We're talking about a world that's about 20 years after World War II, approximately thereabouts, during which we exterminated 6 million Jews. This country interred 100,000 Japanese Americans. We're in a moment at the height of the civil rights movement where black people are struggling and fighting for their lives and their very freedoms that we have today, that we still continue to fight for. We're in a moment in time where we're in a battle with Russia for the space race, but also it's the height of the Cold War. So in 1966, this is the context in which I want you to imagine sitting in front of your television and watching and seeing someone on screen. And what does she see? This is the cast and crew of the USS Enterprise, or you might know them as Star Trek, right? You got Captain Kirk, you got Spock, you got Scotty. But she looked past all those people because she was dead set on seeing someone who looked like her. But I want to tell you about a few of the other people on this crew. See, Gene Roddenberry decided to make Star Trek as this optimistic, diverse look at the future where we were free to look and wrestle with socio-political issues that we were facing today. But he put it in a future where people existed, and the diversity of the people represented here cannot be discounted. So, but not only is there people from Georgia, I'm from Georgia, by the way, we got folks from Scotland. Okay, pretty cool. Leonard Nimoy is an American Jew descended from the Ukraine. Chekhov was from Russia. Lieutenant Sulu, Japan. George Takei, who played Lieutenant Sulu on the show, was interred at the age of 5 in the Japanese internment camps here in the United States. We also have people from the USA. That is the United States of Africa, folks. And who was from there? Well, probably you could take a guess. It was that woman, Nichelle Nichols. She played Lieutenant Commander Uhura, the communications officer of the USS Enterprise. Fourth in command. You've never seen yourself in the future. You've never seen anyone who looks like you. And there she is. That moment was the moment that changed what I would call the future of the way that we see ourselves here and the future that we know that we want to fight and strive for. Because N.K. Jemisin says, who misses what they've never imagined? But now we had a vision of which to imagine and aspire to. So we're going to get in our time machines again, and we're going to fast forward 20 years into the future. It's 1987, and there's a little brown girl with brown skin and black hair sitting on her mom's bed with her sisters, and we're watching Star Trek, The Next Generation. And what do I see on the screen? Whoopi Goldberg standing behind a bar as Texas Guinan, telling James T. Kirk, telling John Luke Picard to get over it. This idea that I took for granted, that we had fought so long just to be seen on screen as we were, but I could be in that moment and I could see myself in a way that didn't inspire the same sort of awestruckness that Whoopi did. What it did was just confirm what I already knew, was that I mattered and I belonged. Also on that show was Levar Burton. As you all may know him as the guy from Reading Rainbow, but I also knew him as Geordi, with the bionic eyes, with the banana combs. Did anybody else from the 80s like walk around with banana combs on your face when you were Geordi, right? All right, so you know, we travel through time with our imagination and our memories, but we also can travel with books. And I find that there's, even as much as I love television, there's no amount of time that you can take that will replace the 2 seconds it takes to transform you to another place, another planet, within like 2 seconds when you open a page. So thank you, Levar Burton. So when I think about this, when I think about the role of science fiction, it's because it allows us to dream. It allows us to imagine possibilities in ways that we can wrestle with as both optimistic and pessimistic, right? So let's go back to 1967. Star Trek has just wrapped its first season. And Nichelle Nichols had the opportunity to pursue her dream career. I don't know if you realize this, but there wasn't like science fiction TV shows as a job, like back in the day, before when Nichelle was growing up. She aspired to be a dancer and a stage performer. She wanted to dance on Broadway. That was her dream. And she finally had a chance to do it. So she walks into Gene Roddenberry's office and she quits the show. Thank you very much. This has been great, but I have a dream job offer. See you later. She takes off and goes that weekend to a fundraising dinner for the NAACP. At the dinner, one of the organizers walks up to her and says, "Hi, Miss Nichols, sorry to disturb you, but one of your fans is here and would really like an autograph." And she goes, "That's nice," thinking it's some Trekkie, "but that person will have to wait because I would like to talk to Dr. Martin Luther King, who's standing right behind you." And he walks up to her, and if you know this story, shut up, don't say anything. Don't spoil it for anyone. He walks up to her and he says, "I'm your biggest fan. My family are your biggest fans. Your TV program is the only TV program that allowed my kids to stay up late and watch." And so they have a conversation in which he thanks her for being on the show, and they talk about the show. And at the end of it, she goes, "Well, I'm so glad that you enjoy it so much, but I'm leaving the series." And this is the actual moment that I wanted to talk to you all about today. Because this moment right here is the reason that I'm here today. Martin Luther King Jr. tells her that she has to stay on the show as an act of activism. Because what she represented that no one else had been able to do in the first place was show that there are black people in the future. And so when I think about that moment, I'm so grateful that she decided to stay and she decided to defer her own dreams in order to become an activist for space, diversification of space in STEM. From 1967 to 1968, 10 years later, Nichelle Nichols at this point had left the show. The show ended in 1969, and she had continued. She started her own STEM company that was about bringing women into the fold, and she was on the board of NASA, and I'm sorry I'm crying, it just makes me so happy. In 1977, NASA decided to start their space shuttle program. They were sending humans into space. And they noticed that all of their applicants were largely male and largely white, and they had a problem. And so they asked Nichelle what they should do about it. And she said, "Well, you should do these things." And they were like, "You should do those things." And she was like, "Okay, I will." 4 months later, their applicant pool went up from, I think it was like 1,000 to 8,000 total. The number of women that applied, the overall is 1,500 to 8,000. The number of women that applied, 100, after 1,600, over 1,600 women applied. Before, minorities, 35, after 1,000 applicants. Guion Bluford, who's from Philadelphia, he graduated from Overbrook High School. who's the first black man in space. We have Sally Ride, the first LGBTQ woman in space. We have Mae Jemison, the first black woman in space. We have Ellison Onizuka, who is a Japanese descendant and a Japanese American, who again, remember, these are people who had been living a life that was of oppression and of lack of recognition. These are people who did not see a future for themselves, and especially here in this country. And these are some of the people who established what we know of as our space program today. Allison, Judy Resnick, the first Jewish person in space, and Ronald McNair, he was the third African-American in space, all perished on the Challenger space shuttle. She single-handedly recruited and mentored these people into our space program. So when I think about her kind of inspiration, it's really, hers is a moment of transformation. She transformed the STEM field, which I think largely influences and is really embedded with the design field. She inspired Afrofuturist visions from writers and movie producers like N.K. Jemisin and Octavia Butler. This is what N.K. Jemisin has to say about the future. First of all, we all get to dream. We all have futures, we all have pasts, we all have stories. And we all, every single one of us, no matter who we are, and no matter what's been taken from us, what poison we've internalized, or how hard we've had to work, expel it. Octavia Butler says, "What good is science fiction's thinking about the present, the future, and the past? What good is its tendency to warn or consider alternative ways of thinking and doing? What good is its examination of the possible effects of science and technology, or social organization and political direction? At its best, science fiction stimulates imagination and creativity. It gets its reader and writer off the beaten track, off the narrow footpath of what everyone is saying, thinking, and doing, whoever everyone happens to be this year. What good is all that to black people? It's everything." And that brings us to our present. So I found a career in industrial design. And for those of you that don't know, industrial design is a design process that's focused on the design of goods. We consider it a strategic problem-solving process that's really about improving people's lives. And we really are about creating an optimistic and profitable future. But to me, that word future holds a lot of meaning. I'm the program director of the product design program here at Drexel University, and I have the privilege of leading a group of students through a curriculum where they get to learn and think about what that future might hold through the lens of design. And that, to me, is a huge responsibility. Because as Octavia Butler says, all that you touch, you change. And all that you change, changes you. The only lasting truth is change. God is change. And so I take my responsibility very seriously. I focus on transforming our world through the lenses of social justice, climate change, and STEAM education and design. And with great power comes great responsibility, probably Ben Parker, I don't know, right? So I take that responsibility into my scholarship and research. I've been able to collaborate on projects focused on climate futures, as well as thinking about what that future might look like for young black girls who look like me, through my program called Black Girls Singing Through Dance. And so when I think about this sense of what the future might hold and what it might bring to us, I think about these moments where people decided to sacrifice their own dreams in order to set a stage so that future generations can benefit and grow. So my question to you is, what moment will you defer so that you can hold space for others so that they may also live long and prosper. Yeah.